Lord, I know you watch my coming and going. I pray for you to watch over me and my family as we travel. Keep us safe in your arms. Let no harm come upon us. Cover us with your mighty wings. Help us to be alert, respectful, and patient as we travel your roads and highways. And now, here's Reverend Sue.
I got Satan on my trail, but I'm singing all is well. He's attacking every day, but I'm watching while I pray. No matter the attack, I won't turn back.
Good evening, and thank you for joining us this evening. I travel a lot in my car, and I have to admit that we have some crazy drivers out here today. Don't get mad at me. I try to do right, but crazy drivers. So I thought about this. I was driving down interstate and I saw the 18-wheeler, but I had to get over in the middle lane because the left lane was ending. And I thought about it. I said, that is an 18-wheeler and I do not play with 18-wheelers. So what I did, I actually said, okay, I'm going to get it over, but I need enough space. So when I get over, I don't have to slow down. I have to keep my speed so it would not be a crash. So I thought about this. And today, this evening, we would like to have a very good friend of ours who is the 18-wheeler driver, Don Hutchins, to tell us how to be safe during the holidays now. We're out vacationing. We don't want nothing to happen to us. So what we want to do is bring the information in. That's what we do on Sunday Evening with Reverend Sue. We bring various type of information, politics, everything that we could think that we know that would be important to our listeners. So today, we have Don Hutchins. He's 18-wheeler, and we have an opportunity to talk to him to try to save the 18-wheeler drivers as well as us. So welcome to our show this evening, Don Hutchins. Thank you for taking the time to be with us.
Good evening, Reverend Sue. Thank you for having me. And while I am not a guest on this show per se, you like my sister, that we're on here talking about this. Oftentimes we're talking about other things that are meaningful because, as you said, I am a truck driver and there are some crazy drivers on the road. Oh my gosh. So let's talk about some of the safety things that we are taught as professional drivers. And that's what they call us, truck drivers, yes, who drive as a profession.
Oh, professional drivers now. We are not truck drivers. Got it.
Yeah. We're truck drivers. But if you ever go into a Love's or a Pilot or a Flying J or a TA, one of these truck stops, and you hear them announce certain things, a lot of times you hear them say professional drivers. And what they're doing is they're calling out a certain segment of their customers to pay attention. So that when I hear that, my ears perk up because I know they're talking to me, at least when I'm in there and I'm driving my truck in that capacity, versus just talking to the general populace.
Yes.
So as a professional driver, there are certain things that we look out for that we do. And let me start where most people generally start, with speed. There's an old saying, we heard it a lot, speed kills. It's very true. And one of the safest things that we can do as drivers is to slow down. And I understand that there are speed limits that are posted. And if you're like me, I tend to drive comfortably 5 miles above the speed limit. At least that's what I do when I'm in my personal vehicle generally. But sometimes we have to look at the conditions and see if those conditions are right for me to drive even up to the speed limit, let alone five more or as some people far exceed that. So speed is a big deal. The next, I think, most critical aspect of safety is following distance, how closely we follow somebody. Now, NTSB, National Transportation and Safety Board, and DOT, Department of Defense, they have these guidelines for regular vehicles for safe following distances, and it's between 3 and 4 seconds. So you think, okay, what's a second? In front of you passes an object, start counting, 1001, 1002, 1003, 1004. If you get to that object before you get to three, you're following too close. Discover, if you've never done that before, is that there's probably way more space that's required than we generally give and that we think in order to follow the safe following distance. And the reason for it.
Can you hold that thought for a second? I've heard people say that they use less gas if they drive behind an 18-wheeler. And an 18-wheeler goes fast.
If they draft them, yes, and drafting, and it only goes up to 65. So if you're trying to get somewhere faster than that, you're going to have to find a truck that doesn't have that kind of restriction that holds it to 65 miles an hour and get behind them. But you will use less gas if you are that close to them to where you're drafting them. It's a concept we see in auto racing where they are so close up on the person in front of them that you can't even see the front of the person behind your vehicle. And as a tractor trailer driver, when I look in my mirrors, and oftentimes trucks will have this sign on the back of them, if you can't see my mirrors, I can't see you. That's very real. So if you're following so closely to the tractor trailer that you can't see their mirrors, then rest assured they can't see your vehicle back there either. Now, you may be drafting and getting good gas mileage, but if they slam on brakes, chances are you don't have enough reaction time to stop before you run into the back of that trailer. And that's not something you want to do, because chances are it may bend the bumper on that trailer. It's going to tear your car up, though, because that bumper is very, very. I've seen the bumper on the back of a tractor trailer when it comes into contact with another tractor trailer. And I've seen the bumper come away unscathed. And the bumper on the truck that hit it was torn up. So you don't want to get into that kind of an altercation, I'll call it, with the back of that trailer. So increase your following distance so that they can see you as well, and you can see around them and see. Mm-hmm. So following distances. The main reason why we need to increase our following distances, whether it's a tractor trailer or a car in front of us, is so that you have enough reaction time if they slam on brakes suddenly, which cars often do. Or if something happens, it gives you enough time to react safely to be able to stop if you need to, or go around if you need to, or what have you, slow down. So following distance is the next thing that we see all the time. We have a lot of safety features in the newer trucks, believe it or not. In fact, they have as many safety features oftentimes as some of the newer cars do. We have collision avoidance, where the truck will slam on brakes for you if it feels like you get too close to a car in front of you. We also have other things, and the company that I drive for, Swift, we have a policy. They would like us to maintain 6 to 8 seconds of following distance between us and the car or truck, the vehicle in front of us. Now, 6 seconds is a long way. It's a lot of distance. And generally what happens is when I'm seeking to maintain that 6 to 8 second space, cars just cut in front of you because, you know, when we pass the truck, we cut over. We pass the truck, we cut over. Well, we also have safety features that when somebody cuts in front of us and cuts us off, one of the things they require us to do is to slow down. So if you're driving along down the highway, and let's say it's 65 miles an hour, and then as soon as you pass that truck, you cut over and get in front of them. Well, you're between that 6 to 8 second space. You are in their safety zone. And so if you ever notice a truck back off of you really abruptly when you pull in front of them, that's why. They're seeking to get that space back that you just took from them by cutting right in front of them. Now, my truck has some safety features. When a car cuts in front of me, I know how close I am to that car in terms of space in seconds, in feet, I know how fast that car is going. All of that shows up on the display in my truck. And second, the second they pull in front of me, and I am often amazed that people will pull in front of a tractor trailer less than a half a second. Like as soon as they get past the bumper, a lot of times they'll cut over, and it's less than a half second. And many times they're doing it because somebody's coming up behind them, and I think they want to move out of the way of the car that's coming up behind them. But I often ask myself, would I be more afraid of the car coming up behind me fast or pulling in front of a tractor trailer that could be loaded at 80,000 pounds? I don't think people are thinking when they do that, because what they're doing is they're depending on that truck to be able to stop in a half a second. It is not going to happen. And a truck going that fast, potentially at that weight, we see some of the horrific accidents that happen when people cut trucks off and what happens with them, because they just cannot, the laws of physics won't allow that truck to stop in enough time. If something happens and that car slams on brakes, well, they might be able to stop before they hit it, but the chances are that truck is not going to stop before they hit them. So that's another reason not to cut in front of them, but to allow enough space when you pass and get over.
I was kind of surprised because, like I said, professional drivers have not been my favorite people in the past years ago, especially when I was going in Pennsylvania, up in Pennsylvania Turnpike. But what I've learned, and you correct me, is that we are the ones that are causing that more accidents.
Usually, we call y'all four-wheelers. The four-wheelers are the ones that cause more accidents than the tractor-trailers. Now, let's be clear. There's some people driving tractor-trailers that shouldn't be driving them. I'm in Richmond. I drove down from the DMV this morning. And while I was driving down, there was a guy driving a tractor trailer that was driving entirely too fast. Now, it's rainy in this area, as it is up in the DMV. So it's wet. One of the things that our company policy mandates is that when the weather is inclement, we slow down even more than the speed limit. Well, mm-hmm. That's a safe practice even for a car to do. This guy was in an 18-wheeler. He comes zooming up on the right side of me. I'm in my personal pickup truck. So he comes zooming up on the right side of me. It's 70 mile an hour zone, and I'm driving 70. He comes zooming up next to me, and there's a pickup truck towing a trailer in front of him, and so he has to slam on brakes because he doesn't have enough space to jump in front of me, which is what he was hoping to do. So he slams on brakes then, gets behind me, and then jumps over into the left lane, comes by me honking his horn. Well, there was two things he didn't realize. Number one, I'm a truck driver just like him, and I drive the same kind of truck he drives. And I know how foolish it is to do what he was doing. And the second thing he didn't realize is that I wish I could have called the police and reported him for reckless driving, because that's what he was doing. At a certain point, after he got over and got in front of me, I decided to pick up speed to see how fast he was going. He was going at least 75 miles an hour in a rainy environment in a tractor trailer. And I'm thinking, I'm pushing the safety limits in a car. He is way over the limits in a truck. And so everybody who is a, quote, professional driver, unquote, doesn't always act like it, just like everybody who is a, quote, Christian, unquote, doesn't always act like it.
So that was the techniques that you as a professional drivers use if someone, like somebody really cuts you off. Unexpectedly, you moving along, doing all the rules and regulations as a professional driver, and somebody just cuts you off. What immediate things that you're going to do to try to save that person's life as well as yours?
The first thing, because as soon as they cut me off, I generally know how fast they're going because it pops up immediately on my dash. I'll glimpse down at that to see how fast they're going. That tells me quickly what I need to do. Now, because we have to check our mirrors quite regularly, like every few seconds or so, we should be checking our mirrors. That car that came zooming up and cut me off, I should know generally how fast they're going. I should have an idea if they're going about my speed and they zoom in front of me or not. I see it. then generally I might honk my horn to let them know what they did wasn't smart. But I generally won't slam on brakes because they're going so much faster than I am. In 2 seconds, they're going to be long gone from in front of my truck. So it all depends on what they're doing. Now, sometimes people do some really aggravating things in that they're barely driving faster than I am, maybe 2 miles per hour faster than me, and then they cut over right in front of me. Well, the first thing I'm going to do then is slow down because they are in my zone and they're not going fast enough to clear that zone anytime soon before I'll get a safety event that pops up. And that's what happens. We have 3 seconds to react when somebody pulls in front of us. Otherwise, we'll get a safety event that actually records the event. And we have cameras in the truck. We have outward-facing cameras. And the main reason for that is so that when something happens, there's a recording 10 seconds before it happened and 10 seconds after it happened. And so if the person is going that slow, I might flash my lights or hit my horn to let them know, look, what you just did is not too smart. You know, pulling in front of a truck and barely going faster than the truck. You're in the safety zone, basically. So the first thing you should do is assess whether safely enough they're going to get out of your way, and if not, slow down. And if I'm in a position to do it, sometimes, believe it or not, people will come over and cut right over in front of you, and there is nobody behind them. And what I often do is I will get over in the left lane or move over from them as soon as they do that until they go out farther enough in front of me to where I can get back over.
Doing my research and also talking to you is that we as drivers, we need to do better. And that's why this is so important right now, is that we need to do better when we get in our cars and understand all the rules and regulations that you have right now, which you have to go through every single day. And I'm glad that we're taking time to do this, because pray to God that somebody's life will be saved because of this session.
Yes, absolutely. Because everybody who drives a vehicle has a responsibility for safety. Everybody. In fact, there's a sticker that's often in the window of the trucks that we drive that says, you are the only person responsible for the safety operation of this vehicle. And I think if everybody had that reminder in their car that they're the ones responsible for that vehicle being operated safely, and we were to drive like we understand that, I think they would put a lot fewer people's lives at risk on the highway. Because driving is inherently dangerous. Anytime you have cars driving at various speeds and so many of them and moving and changing lanes and all of the things that we can do to make it safer is helpful. There's another saying, a sign I've seen at some of our terminals that says, no matter how much safety equipment is on the truck, you have to be the one responsible for safety. And what that speaks to is some of the collision avoidance safety features that are on the truck. All the things that, you know, lane departure warnings, you know, they have cars that when you start to depart from your lane without having a turn signal on, it'll give you a lane departure warning. And in some cases, it'll bring the vehicle back. All of those are wonderful safety features, but they do not replace the driver. And so we have to understand it's our responsibility to safely operate that vehicle.
Okay. And also, just a little bit of information in reference to, not on the road, but in our neighborhood. So you see the trucks come by in our neighborhood, right? And say, why is that truck coming down that street? Is that legal or what? Or should we report it? Or we should have information already available in our community whether a truck should go down a particular street or not go down a particular street?
That's a great question. It depends. Some streets have signs that say no trucks. And for obvious reasons, sometimes there are clearance issues with trees, with power lines, with those kinds of things. And as a truck driver, we're always looking for signage because trees are a problem for us. Power lines are a problem for us. Bridges and overpasses or underpasses are a problem for us because the height of the truck and the trailer that I drive is 13 feet, 6 inches. So I need at least that much clearance. So if in your neighborhood, It depends on what kind of truck it is as well. It could be a delivery truck. If they're delivering something to one of your neighbors, well, you can't really report that. It could be a dump truck and they're doing construction down your street. Well, you can't really report that as well because they have a right to be there in both instances. A lot of times you'll see a sign that says no through traffic. And that's not even just specific to trucks. That's to people trying to cut through your neighborhood, the shortcut to get to somewhere else, particularly when there's a backup of traffic somewhere else. And a lot of those neighborhoods have those signs because people like to cut through neighborhoods and they have those signs up there to cut down on that. But it depends. If you detect a pattern of somebody whom you can determine shouldn't be there and they're cutting through the neighborhood, I'd say have a little grace because sometimes they may have made a wrong turn. We use GPSs a lot. All of us do. And if anybody who's ever used a GPS has gone the wrong way because of crazy instructions from a GPS. Now, I have two GPSs in my truck, but that still doesn't mean that they don't give me crazy instructions sometimes.
Right.
So sometimes it could be that they went down the street accidentally.
Thank you.
And
going back to this, our times went up. Going back to being on the highway again. I know a long time ago, that I was told that professional drivers would stay on the right lane. If it's a three lane, stay on the right lane and then the middle lane, but never the left lane. Okay. Then if it's a two lane. Okay, explain that.
That's a good point. And you see a lot of signs on the highways where there are restrictions. You see them all the time where it'll say no trucks in the left lane or no commercial vehicles in the left lane. Buses are allowed. You'll see that sign a lot. And generally that's a three-lane road and they want the trucks to stay out of the left lane for passenger cars and buses to go. And so trucks can be in the right lane and then can pass other vehicles in the middle lane, but not be all the way in the left lane of three. And if it's two lanes, I've been driving for over 40 years. And when I got my license at 16, as many people do, particularly in places like Georgia, where I'm from, as soon as the day of your birthday, if the place is open, you go get your license and drive. And so I've been driving that long, but I was fortunate enough at 18 to be sent to Germany, where I really learned how to drive. And one of the rules of the Autobahn is, it's the same rule that we have in America, where it says right lane, slower traffic, keep right, left lane is for passing only. You see those signs. And sometimes I was coming from Kansas the other day, and in a lot of states, it'll say state law, left lane for passing only. I see that. But that doesn't stop people from hanging out, camping in the left lane. And so what I learned when I went to Germany, though, is you drive so fast on the Autobahn in places where there's no speed limit that you, for a safety reason, better get over out of the left lane. Pass people, get over. So I've developed that habit early on. And so that's my mantra when I'm driving. Pass people, get over. And the only time I'm not hanging out in the right lane is if I'm passing by an exit where people are coming on, traffic is merging on, I'll get over to allow them to be able to merge on. But you bring up a good point. And people in cars, I see trucks doing it too. They're guilty as well. But people generally don't recognize that the left lane is for passing. And that's really what it's for. And the right lane is for just driving. And then you get over. Because people are lazy. They don't want to, I got to keep getting over because I have to keep passing people. Well, if you have to pass everybody on the road, maybe you're driving too fast. Maybe you need to slow down. And understand that driving...
I don't want to cut you off, but I'm glad you mentioned that. Because people don't realize that the left lane is for passing. It's not to drive in the left lane throughout this country. The left lane is
for passing. And there's signs.
Florida, so I grew up in a country, so I know about the tractors getting in your way that you got to pass them. On the farm,
right?
But also knew about in Florida with the express lanes, people stay in that left lane, and they should get out of the left lane if they're not passing. Just that simple. So we're gonna close now. I can talk to you all day about professional drivers. The reason, and I would like for our listeners, please, brothers and sisters, listen to Don. Go back and you know, do the YouTube thing. Listen to Don, because it's so important that we are out here. We are responsible. You know, over 70, 60 something percent, Don didn't mention that we are causing the accidents, not the professional drivers. Please listen to us. We love us. And we don't want to cause accidents out here. And please, another thing, stop driving like we are definitely insane. Totally crazy out here.
Yes.
Insane. What do you want? You trying to commit suicide or something? I mean, I don't know. But it's really on my heart. I see too many accidents. I see too many crazy drivers out here. And we need to stop it. We need to stop it. So
slow down. Put the phones down.
Continue the work that you're doing. And pray for your other drivers. Pray for your other drivers out here. And when I stop at a truck stop, I'm gonna say, I take my hat off to you. You women and men out here on the road, and we crazy drivers out here causing some many, many things to happen. So thank you for joining us. We appreciate you. And one thing, just 1 second that you can tell us, one statement that we need to listen to. Just one.
Stop the distracted driving. That's my last takeaway.
Thank you, and have a good trip wherever you are right now. And we'll talk later.